I told these guys they have to get that memorized. The order of the feast. And I want to say in the fall of 2004, I got infected in an emergency room with Staph aureus, a MRSA that everybody was dying from. Every doctor gave up hope for me. I had a PICC line into my heart for 2 months. For 8 weeks, I did a daily IV that stole some of my life, but I lived. Amen. And that's why I came up and laid hands on Devin. And he will live in Jesus' name. Lord. I brought the signs again because everybody has said it really helps. But I will tell you that I'm not doing what I thought I'd be doing because the Lord just gave me a whole different message. He's weaving a whole new message I've never given before. So you're going to get it straight off the press. Probably the most perfect scripture in all of the Bible is Genesis 1:1. And Terry, if he has the scriptures, we'll be putting them up. But that scripture is, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And you won't know that that's the most perfect scripture unless you go to the Hebrew. And you go to the original Hebrew, which is pictorial, picture Hebrew. And praise the Lord, we have men and women who have studied that pictorial Hebrew for over 30 years now. And I glean from them. It's amazing. Terry, go ahead and put the Hebrew up. I have an image there. Okay, Hebrew, and I got my little laser pointer. Hebrew is read from right to left. Okay? Do you see that first Hebrew letter there? That's bigger and enlarged. That's a bet, and it stands for a house. Think of a floor plan of a house, and there you have the opening to the house. Now, there is no capitalization in Hebrew, okay, but it's enlarged in many Hebrew scripts. And what that is saying, the very first letter of the very first Hebrew word of Scripture, is that God is building a house. And I'll tell you, Don, your vision was too little because here's what we're building. Yes, we're going to have our new church and new sanctuary, but we're building the house of God. Now, it gets better than that. So this is really the Father's desire to have a big family. If you take that first letter off, just take that first letter off, the word that remains then is reshit, which means first or choice. And then if you look further inside that Hebrew word, you'll find one Hebrew letter that stands for the mark, the covenant. And if you break that word down a little bit further, you'll find the word for fire. Oh, yeah. So there's going to be a covenant involving fire that's going to be a part of gathering the first fruits into the house, all in that word. And then here, see that word right there? It's pronounced et. It's an aleph tav, which is the first and the last letters of the Hebrew alphabet. There's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. It's like saying from A to Z, you know, everything's included from A to Z. Well, Jesus is the aleph tav. He's the first and the last, the beginning and the end, and he's the alpha and omega. And we go to John 1:1-2. Leave that up, Terry, because you don't have the scripture that says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God. Right there. There he is. I can't keep that. Still, he was in the beginning with God. That's what it says in John 1. Isn't that cool? Now, guess what? He's over here, too. Do you see the aleph tav there? But do you see that third Hebrew letter behind it? That Hebrew letter stands for a nail.
A what?
A nail. So there you have Yeshua with a nail between heaven and earth. How do you like that? When we say the Word of God is alive, it is. Get in the Word. The words of men do not have this. I believe if every atheist would study the original Hebrew, and we're not even talking about the numeric equivalents, we're not talking about anything else. Only the Creator God could take a language and orchestrate it with history. Amen. Now, this is also why Revelations 13:8 says that the Lamb was slain from the foundation. You have to know that even before creation, God, Father God, Abba, had a vision of a house full of children created in His image. And He knew what would happen. This plan was put in place before He ever said, "Let there be light." He's building a house. Now, we know what happened. He created Adam and Eve, and they were created in His image. And we know they got stolen away, right? You know, the devil came and deceived them and stole them away. And let me see where I am. And it wound up, death came into the scene, both spiritual and natural death, eternal separation from God. But there's hope. There's a glimmer of hope here because the Lord prophesied over the serpent. Genesis 3:15, a key scripture. "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." So there's the hope of a plan of redemption coming forth. The problem was is that God needed a legal way to get back into mankind. He had lost the legal right to his children. And so he looked for a man, and he found one in Genesis 12. He found Abram. And he said in Genesis 12, "Get out of your country to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation, and your descendants will bless all the families of the earth." Oh, yeah. So right there in the beginning of Genesis 12, we see that he's about world redemption. Amen. He's found one man who will, in faith, do what he needs to do, leave everything behind, and go to a place that he doesn't even know where he's going yet. That's Abraham. This is the beginning of our true Hebraic roots. I mean, the original Hebrew is the language of heaven. Only God could have designed it. And then, of course, Abram is the original Hebrew. The seed of world redemption is going to come through Abraham. So he believes the Lord, and it's accounted to him for righteousness of faith. God then ratifies a covenant with him as an unconditional, unbreakable blood covenant. Remember, we saw the fire in the covenant in Genesis 1:1, because the Lord, as a smoking oven and a burning torch, walked through those animal halves that Abraham had prepared. Abram, he went through a name change. Abram means exalted or high father. His name was changed to Abraham, which is father of many nations. World redemption once again. God tests Abraham on the covenant. He tells him to go to the land of Moriah, and he'll identify a mountain. Here's the first place where Jerusalem comes up. Because on the mountain where Abraham almost sacrificed Isaac is the future place of the temple of God. Okay, so that's the first case of it. Of course, you know, God stopped him and provided a substitute. But Abraham had the faith that he would have done it if God had not stopped him. So Abraham's descendants do become a mighty nation. And when they're at the foot of Mount Sinai and they accept the Lord's betrothal proposal, the nation of Israel is born. And as I talk about Israel, I'm not talking about political Israel today. I am talking about the Israel that are the children of God, that are to be a light to the nations, and that are to birth the nations into the kingdom. So keep that. Keep you in your mind whenever I say Israel. Okay? Now, God chose the place of the promised land, which is much greater than current Israel. Terry, put that image up when you can get it. There are several scriptures. I'm not going to go through the scriptures, but if you take all those scriptures and put them together, there's the boundaries of the promised land. You know, all of Jordan is in there. You know, and of course, Israel doesn't have that much land today. But we need to know that that's what God intended. Israel was placed at the center of the trade routes of the known world. God did that specifically. He chose this land. They were to be a light to the nations. They were to give birth to the nations into the kingdom. Think about Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. And God gave them ordinances to keep them separate from the other nations so that the other nations would say, wow, look at this wise and understanding people. They're not doing stuff the way we do them. Okay? That's what the law was all about. Now, King David conquers Jerusalem in 2 Samuel 5. This is the Mount Moriah again. And he buys a threshing floor from Ornan the Jebusite. 1 Chronicles 21, 24 through 5 is very instrumental. Because Ornan said, well, he saw the angel of the Lord there. He said, I'll give it to you. And David said, no. For I will not take what is yours for the Lord, nor offer burnt offerings with that which cost me nothing. He knew that he had to pay a high price. And he paid 600 shekels of gold by weight. The number 6 is there, is very important. And we'll talk about that later. King David repents for numbering Israel, and he declares in 1 Chronicles 22:1, this is the house of the Lord God. When there was nothing there, but it was a wheat threshing floor, and he had just built an altar, but he declares, this is the house of the God. David was amazing, as you will see. Now, David was in a time of peace, dwelling in his house. And in 2 Samuel 7:2, he said to Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwells inside tent curtains. So, and Nathan knew what he was saying, that he wanted to build a house for the Lord. And he said to go do what you have. But actually, it was Daniel Jester, who's with Asher and Trader, released this earlier this year at an Israel conference. And it just almost threw me on the floor. He said that David was so much into the heart of the Father, so much to the heart of the Father, that he discerned that the Father's desire is to dwell with us here on earth in person.
Yeah.
Do y'all get that?
Yes.
Does that like revolutionize something for you? Yes. You know, I always thought, why does he want us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem? Why are we paying? Because if I pray for the peace of Jerusalem, I'm praying for the Lord's return, because there's not going to be any human peace in Jerusalem. But we are to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, because that's the Father's heart.
Amen.
To live with us face to face as his children in the new Jerusalem, which will be on the earth.
Amen.
Where, so when you're praying for the peace of Jerusalem, you're praying for the Father's heart desire to come and live with us. For that family that he envisioned at the very beginning. There's stuff in here straight from the Father. I'm just the messenger, you guys. Stay with me. There's stuff in here that will change your life. So anyway, the Lord came to Nathan in a dream and said, tell David, he's not the one to build the temple, but his son can build me a temple. But he was so honored. He was so honored by David's discerning of his heart that in 2 Samuel 7:13, he says, and it's Solomon, he's talking about the Lord, Solomon shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. So this is what we call the Davidic covenant. So we know when Jesus comes back and sits on the throne in Jerusalem during the millennium kingdom, he's sitting on the throne of David. Benjamin Netanyahu is sitting in a chair as prime minister that has the authority of that same throne right now. Hallelujah. So God chose Jerusalem, and Solomon did build the temple. And this is the same place where Abraham almost sacrificed Isaac. In 1 Kings 9:3, and the Lord said to him, he's talking to Solomon, I have heard your prayer and your supplication that you have made before me. I have consecrated this house which you have built to put my name there forever, and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. Hallelujah. So Jerusalem, listen to this, Jerusalem within Israel is the spiritual womb of the kingdom of God on earth. But, you know, the Israelites, they kind of went along and they had some problems. They really didn't keep up with their end of the bargain. And you'll find, the Mosaic covenant, they were supposed to be a light. And then in Isaiah 26:18, they're saying, we have been with child, we have been in pain. This is through Isaiah. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. Instead of birthing that kingdom on earth of the nations, they birthed wind. We have not accomplished any deliverance in the earth, nor have the inhabitants of the world fallen. So the nation of Israel, remember this is a holy nation of priests that were birthed at Mount Sinai. They failed in their mission, but Jesus already knew that because he was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So Jesus has a plan of redemption. He has a strategy for redeeming the world. They're called feasts in Leviticus 23, but they're not really feasts. I mean, we're to celebrate them because he's actually going to do them. But they are seven divine appointments when Jesus is going to interact with heaven and earth. And through these seven divine appointments, he's going to win the whole redemption of us, amen. Not only us, but all of the earth and all of the universe. Okay? And seven is the number of perfection. So we know that Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits originally was done in the Exodus from Egypt. Okay? But these three spring feasts is also the crucifying of Jesus, him going into hell, conquering death and the serpent and all that, and him rising from the dead as first fruits. Okay? There will be a future manifestation of Passover in end times when we do not have to go through the second death. Okay, Pentecost. The first time of Pentecost was the giving of the Torah on Mount Sinai. I believe that because Jesus is the Word. And then, of course, the upper room when the Holy Spirit was poured out. And then we come to the fall feast. So I am standing in between the manifestation of these. Now, remember, there can be multiple manifestations, but these are yet to come. And the Lord showed me that the original of these is in Nehemiah. when Israel is standing broken before the Lord in Jerusalem, weeping and coming back to the Lord. So, there's also three harvests with the first fruits. You need to know that first fruits is the barley harvest. And this is the harvest associated with the overcomers, the first fruits of the Lord, the overcomers. Pentecost is associated with the wheat harvest. This is the harvest for the rest of the believers. Okay? And the fall feast is the ingathering of the fruit, and the grapes are really related to the unbelievers that will be thrown into the wine press of the wrath of God. So let me get some water. So somebody tell me, this is the second coming of Christ here. Why is Jesus, Yeshua, coming back to earth? Somebody shout it out.
Redeem the earth.
What else? Yeah, most people will automatically say for his bride. I've asked that question several times, and it's usually he's coming back to gather us, to gather his bride. Yes, he's going to do that. But he's going to do so much more. He's not finished yet on earth. Yes, he said on the cross, it is finished. And he did actually finish it completely on the cross. He got all authority back. But, you know, he hasn't totally crushed the head of evil, right? There's lots for him that he's going to do. And one of the things he wants to do this morning is expand your vision. Because he's coming back to do a lot. And he doesn't want to do it alone.
Right.
He wants you to do it with him.
Amen.
There's a tribulation coming up. And we don't care if you believe in a pre-tribulation rapture or mid or post. I'm post. I'm preparing for the tribulation. You don't need to write the pastors, okay? You be Berean, study the word. But you ought to look up the origin, because I looked up the origin of the rapture theology, and he came up with that theology because he had no theology to combine the Gentiles and the Jews together. That tells you something, so just go there. But there's a tribulation coming, and we want to be right next to the Lord, like as close as you can get. And you know what? You cannot be right next to the Lord unless you know who you are and are walking in your true identity. If you have shame from your past, you're going to... You may feel close, but you're going to move away. I really heard that from him. We have to know who we are. We have to know the word before we go into end times. Other things that are coming, there's going to be a great falling away of the church. It's prophesied. There's going to be an unholy trinity. The Antichrist is going to rise. The false prophet's going to rise. Satan makes up that threesome. All nations are going to come against Jerusalem. That is prophesied yet to come. There's going to be the resurrection of the dead, the gathering of us in the air. The nations, Jesus is going to come back. The nations are going to be judged. He's going to deal with the unholy Trinity.
That's right.
Do you know how he's going to do it? If you don't know, get into Revelations. Because he wants us with him. Please hear that. He wants us with him.
Amen.
And then we're going to see the complete end of this age and the beginning of the millennial kingdom. It's like a woman giving birth. Someone has actually done the gestation cycles through the feast. When a woman gives birth to something new, that new baby, it's worse right before the baby's born. So these will be the most tumultuous days on earth. And we're close. I have this urgency inside of me, and some people do not understand why I will not enter into traditions of man. But when you look at Genesis 1:1 and you see the life that's in the Word, I'm Word-based, okay? And these feasts are in Leviticus 23. Can you put that up, Terry? He says to Moses, "Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, the feast of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations, these are my feast." And if you go through that chapter, it's like 40-something times he says either directly or indirectly, "They're mine, they're mine, they're not Jewish." Folks, be careful when you add things to the life of the Word, because this is his redemptive strategy. And his Word, both Logos and Rhema, is going to guide us through these times to the end. So, let's see where I am. Then we get to Revelations 21:6. At the very end, he's going to say, "It is done." Do you have that one, Terry? Revelation. It's done. "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give the fountain of water of life freely to him who thirsts." Hallelujah. Okay, so what kind of people should we be?
Thirsty?
Yeah, you're drinking right there, too. That's good. I believe, Joseph, you're drinking special water right there, straight from the Spirit.
Amen.
We will not be able to navigate end times safely unless we know who we are and unless we know the Word. And Jesus is saying, "I want you to rise up." Dee Dee, you prophesied it earlier, accelerated growth. I was sitting back there listening to you. That prophecy that you released earlier in this sanctuary is where we're going. Because the Lord is opening something here that will allow you to be caught away to become that overcomer bride. So we're going to the story of Boaz and Ruth. Now, Boaz and Ruth took place in some pretty bad times, right? The time of Judges. The most violent stories in the Bible are in the book of Judges. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes, okay? And sounds like today, right? Now, Ruth was a Gentile from Moab, which the Israelites hated them. But she got a glimpse of God, and she abandoned everything to go to an unknown country. Doesn't that sound like a little bit like Abraham? Matthew 10:39, this so fits here. "He who finds his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it." She lost her life in order to find life. She leaves everything behind. Now, they came to Bethlehem, guess what? At the beginning of the barley harvest. It says it right there in the Word. So they come to Bethlehem at the time of first fruits. And Ruth gleaned barley in the field until evening. And time passes and time passes. You know, gleaning barley is really just survival mentality. The Lord doesn't want us living with survival mentality anymore. But they get to the end. They're getting close to the end of the harvest and nothing's happened yet. And so the Holy Spirit is working in Naomi. And she gets a strategy straight from the Holy Spirit. And she knows that Boaz is winnowing barley on the threshing room floor. So she tells Ruth in Ruth 3:3, "Therefore, wash yourself and anoint yourself. Put on your best garment and go down to the threshing floor." She's basically saying, get all gussied up. You know, you're stepping out of this survival mentality and we're stepping up. Because Ruth and Boaz is a prophetic picture of Jesus the King and his spiritual remnant bridal church as they go through end times. Because this is a time where everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And so, Naomi, you got to get this. If you're feeling tired, I will not be offended if you stand up, okay? Some of y'all want to stand up and stretch, but you got to get this. Naomi, as a descendant of Abraham, passes on her ethnic right of redemption to Ruth, the Gentile from Moab. Wow. Naomi prophetically exalts Ruth, who has been grafted into Israel, to her rightful place as a joint heir of the kingdom. It's right there in the book of Ruth. Did you get it? It could have been any one of you if you had lived in that time period. Now, Ruth does not hesitate, but she steps into her true identity and she lays at Boaz's feet in humility, and he is greatly pleased. Greatly pleased. He not only receives her, but he blesses her. In Ruth 3:10, he says, "Blessed are you of the Lord, my daughter, for you have shown more kindness at the end than at the beginning, and that you did not go after young men, whether rich or poor or rich." Ruth chose right. It was a risk. She could have been killed. Said, stone this woman coming down to the threshing floor at night. Yeah, you're totally right. But she forsook the things of the world, and she chose the King. In Ruth 3:15, Boaz gives Ruth 6 ephahs of barley, which we'll see later is important. Remember, David paid 600 for the field, and now Boaz is giving 6. It's like bushels, 6 bushels. He says, "Bring the shawl that is on you and hold it." In Ruth 3:15, when she held it, he measured 6 ephahs of barley and laid it on her. But there was a complication. Someone had a first claim to her, and he had to go deal with that entanglement. And she had to wait. She had to wait until Boaz, the king, makes a way for her to become his bride. So here we have the threshing room process. As Ruth is waiting, the Holy Spirit is very much at work on that barley threshing floor, working through Boaz, working through her. She's tossed up into the air. Oh, I forgot to tell y'all that. Oh. The way you winnow barley is you toss it into the air. And the wind, the movement of it going through the air removes the outer hull, the husk. And so Naomi's being tossed in the air, and she's having that old identity taken off of her, and Boaz is making the way to redeem her, because everything of the world must come off of her. She has to be a pure and spotless bride. So now let's talk about barley. Barley, y'all are going to love this. I mean, this revelation came out last year, believe it or not. But it wasn't complete. The Lord's completing it this year because this is the time for it. Yeah. Barley is hardy. It can weather freezing, and it can weather drought and heat. That's not true of wheat. Remember, we're talking about the overcomers here. The first fruits. The barley ripens at Passover. So any matzah at Passover in the land back in ancient times was barley, matzah bread. And you can buy barley matzah bread, which I'm going to start doing. Barley does represent the first fruits overcoming anointing. Now, here's the other thing. You can't make this up. Only the creator of the universe could do this. But barley and flax are the first things to ripen in the land. Do you know what's made from flax?
Linen.
So at the same time that barley is harvested, which is the overcomers, linen is also made from the flax harvested at the same time, and it's used to make the priestly garments. To be clothed in linen from flax is to put on the righteousness and purity of Christ. Revelations 19:8. Terry, if you could put it up. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Barley in the Bible is also associated with major supernatural miracles. Gideon is another one who stepped out of old identity into new. Okay? He had victory over the Midianites. How did he have that victory? He didn't even use weapons. But he heard them talking about a dream that they had where a loaf of barley fell into the camp of the Midianites. And the Midianites knew that they were toast. Gideon won the battle with, what was it? He had a shofar and a lantern. No weapons. Well, those were weapons, but not like a sword or whatever. Elisha and the feeding of 100 men. Who did he feed? What did he feed them? He fed them barley loaves. And did you know that when Jesus fed the 5,000 in John 6, it was 5 barley loaves? Are you getting the picture? And Jesus, Paul actually wrote in Romans 8:23, he said, not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit. We have the first fruits of the Spirit. We have the barley. We groan within ourselves. What Paul is saying here, remember, the first fruits is the beginning of the harvest. It implies that there's a greater harvest to come. So we have the first fruits of the Spirit, but we're going to get all the rest. Paul is saying here that the measure of the Holy Spirit that we now have is but a foretaste of the greater measure of the Spirit coming. We are to be more than gleaners ahead. And Ruth was blessed by the people and the elders of the city. Ruth 4:11. These are the people of the city blessing her. They say, the Lord make the woman who is coming to your house, Boaz, like Rachel and Leah, the two who built the house of Israel. Now, when we say the house of Israel, I'm thinking of that house that Father God wants to build back in Genesis 1:1. Rachel and Leah were the two wives of Jacob, later who was later named Israel, and they gave birth to the 12 tribes. So Ruth is blessed to build that house. Boaz redeems Ruth and makes her his bride, and they give birth to Obed, and he is the father of Jesse, the father of David, in the lineage of Jesus. Now, Boaz gives Ruth 6 ephahs of barley. And then put Ruth 3:15 up, Terry. This is where he measures out 6 ephahs of barley. When I was working on this, that 3:15 jumped off the screen at me, and I was like, oh my gosh. Now put up Genesis 3:15. The bruising of the head of the serpent. He made sure those numbers matched on those scriptures because Ruth is prophetic to the spiritual remnant bride that's going to be right by Jesus' side when he goes through all of this. He's not going to do it alone.
That's right.
Because that's not how he chooses to work.
Amen.
Six bushels. I researched this. Six bushels is not humanly possible to carry. Are you getting it? It's not by anything human. It's going to be a supernatural work of the Spirit. So this is a supernatural equipping, and the number six represents man. In its first fruits, always there's the implication of the greater harvest that's coming. So I wrote this from the Lord. I'm just going to read it. Just receive it, okay? What we see here in this story, and I am declaring prophetically over our GOMZ body and to everyone who watches by live stream, that a Gentile Moabite woman who abandons all she has ever known for the one true God is who Ruth is. She abandons all. No longer a gleaner and a foreigner, she sheds her old identity and fully steps into the powerful identity prepared for her before she was formed in the womb. She is grafted into the natural olive tree named Israel, and she receives the rite of redemption to betroth and marry the Lord of the harvest. Her betrothal gift from him is a mighty supernatural empowerment and gifting to bring in the greatest harvest ever known. She will do the greater works, for as she brings in this harvest, she is building up and filling up the house of God that was envisioned from the very beginning. She will not stop. She will not rest. She will persevere until the end, until the house of God is overflowing with family and the desires of the Father's heart have been met.
Yes.
The barley threshing floor is a place of surrender. The Lord opened it a year ago on the night, Tuesday night, we did the Feast Trumpets. I've put myself on it, and there's a few of us in here that we've gone through some hard times this year, but praise the Lord that he went deep and exposed stuff that needed to come out, and we got the healing, and we got the deliverance.
Yeah.
The barley threshing floor is a place of surrender, of telling Jesus that you choose him over the world. It is a place of stripping, of laying down the past and the false identity that you have carried your whole life.
Right.
Yeshua will not force you to come to this barley threshing floor. You have to come voluntarily, just like Ruth did, and lay down in humility and let him do his work. He is calling us higher and closer to him than we have ever been. He wants to take you to a place that you cannot even imagine. And Pastor Dave, you said that this morning. I already had it written down.
Yeah.
Okay. Boy, right there in the book of Ruth. Did you know we're going to look a little bit at New Testament, and I'm watching the time here. The Mosaic law had certain ordinances that was to keep the Israelites separate from the nations. And that was so that they would see the light and they would live according to that law or whatever. But we know they didn't follow that. They kind of did their own thing and they weren't really the light. Now, the tabernacle in the wilderness and the temple, we know from Moses and other scripture, was patterned after a heavenly temple that Moses saw. There was an outer court, inner court, there was a holy place, and then there was a holy of holies where only the priest went, okay? The Gentiles could worship in the outer court, but they couldn't go any further. If they did, they could be killed. The sentence was death. There was a middle barrier separating the Gentiles, where the Gentiles could go and where the Jews could go. Israel failed in giving birth to the nations and the kingdom. Now, this part right here, again, is from Daniel Juster. Pride over their Jewish and ethnic identity produced hostility between the Jew and Gentile. And it's really good to hear that from a Jewish man who lives in Israel. I don't think Father God, our Abba, was pleased with that, because remember, his heart was for that house, for that family. So when Jesus died, he annihilated those ordinances. Every ordinance that spoke of separation, he annihilated it. And that veil in the temple was torn from top to bottom. Who do you think tore it? I believe Father God reached down and ripped that thing in two, because it was so, they had just really perverted it. And he had to destroy that. Jesus annihilated everything that speaks of separation. Children of God are now defined by being born anew of the Spirit of Christ, those who have experienced the new birth, and not through a Jewish identity, ethnic identity. And a lot of people believe that's the case of the Old Testament, but the kingdom of God has always been Jew and Gentile, even in the Old Testament. I could list a whole list of Gentiles that got grafted in. Right. It's always been about world redemption. Ephesians 2, 11 through 22, I have to declare it. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity. That is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, and that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross. Y'all join me. Thereby putting to death the enmity, and he came and preached peace to you who were afar off and to those who were near. For through him we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Hallelujah! Ephesians 2, 6, and Terry put that up. You have been raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Where are we sitting in the heavenlies? We're sitting in the Holy of Holies. Third heaven, paradise, a restored Garden of Eden almost even. We are in the Holy of Holies. When Naomi gave Ruth her right of redemption, Ruth was raised up as high as she could possibly go in both the natural and the spiritual realms, because he raised her up to marry the king. It's a beauty. It happened. The story of Boaz and Ruth is real, but it is a prophetic picture of where the Lord wants us to go. We are with him. Jesus is the one that made the way manifest into the Holy of Holies. Hebrews 10, 19. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God. Wow, we That's where we are. So how does this impact your identity? To have this released from heaven today to you. I'm the messenger, but I've already stepped into it. Amen. I can tell you that. You are no longer a foreigner, for you have been grafted into the natural olive tree, the holy nation of priests named Israel. And so now you have an identity with Israel. Did you know that? You do not become Jewish. And you do not need to pick up Jewish customs and traditions. You be who you are. The Father is looking for those out of every nation who worship in spirit and truth. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. The mystery of the gospel is that we are joint heirs and fellow members of the body of Christ. There's nothing to hold you back. Okay, I'm going to skip over a little bit because I'm trying to be very careful with time. So, the Lord had me do it in this sequence. You have to be that identity that we've been talking about. You've got to let go of the past. You've got to let go of your false identity before we hit this stuff. The Lord wants you up, close to him, near to him, walking in your true identity, and he wants you riding with him through this whole journey. Come to the nights. I'm not going to talk about these a lot this morning because the Lord wanted to expand your vision and release identity. I believe every single one of you will be touched today in a pretty, a stupendous way. It'll be as stupendous as you want it to be. But, you know, this is the Feast of Trumpets. It's incorrectly called Rosh Hashanah, and I will say that because Asher Intrader says that. I love Asher Intrader. He's got an end times calling, just like Bruce and I have, and he is preparing for these days. We have apostolic, messianic, Jewish believers in Israel that are rightly hearing from God, and I praise God that they're there. So Asher believes that when we hear this trumpet call, this is Yom Teruah, that we is the beginning of the tribulation. Now, Paul Wilbur, our oversight, believes that when we hear this trumpet call, that it will be the second return of Christ. We don't know yet. Nobody knows the true sequence. Okay, but we do know that there is a Teruah trumpet call that is coming, that's going to be blasted from heaven. And Devorah, you got release it. I've asked Devorah just to release that call. Joel 2:1, blow the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is at hand. And 1 Thessalonians 5:4 through 6 says, look, guys, I'm just going to paraphrase it. You're not in darkness. You should be surprised by this. You are children of light. You are children of the most holy God. You're in his house. Amen. You will know it's going to come and be blown before it even happens. Yeah. Everything's building to a climax. All nations are going to come against Jerusalem. The Lord's prophesied it. We believe his word. We don't pick and choose. And we believe it's literally going to happen. This is a literal return of Christ. And he's going to come down and conquer those nations. And all of those nations will be brought under his rule and authority. The Day of Atonement has always been about the repentance and cleansing of Israel as a nation. The Day of Atonement is going to be when all those nations are before the Lord. And skip over Zechariah 14, Terry, and go to Revelations. Well, no, wait a minute. Oh, we'll skip over. No, put up Revelations 19:11. Just trying to shorten this a little bit. Now, this is the vision of the Lord coming back. Now, I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. I only put the first verse there, but you need to go to Revelation, because his eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many crowns, and it goes on and on and on. You will not be able to be with him in your false identity.
Oh, that's so good.
This is the Lord of hosts. This is the master and commander of the armies of heaven. And for those of y'all that were at HBI on Tuesday night, Nancy McDaniel did this amazing presentation on warring with the names of God, and she went into the Lord of hosts. His eyes are fire. You choose who you want to be. I want to be right here riding with him. Okay, now, Terry, go ahead and put up Matthew 25. In Matthew 25, 31, 32, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from his goats. Day of Atonement, during the day, we invite you to come up Thursday during the day from 9 to 5. Bruce and I are going to be here, and we're going to be praying for the nations. We're going to pray a week from this coming Thursday, October 13th. We're going to be praying for the nations because the spiritual remnant, the first fruits, the spiritual remnant of every nation has blessings and implication toward the greater harvest of their nation. We're going to pray for the U.S. and Israel, and we're going to pray for every tribe, tongue, people, and nation that do not have a remnant yet. Tabernacles. This is when the end of this age ends and the millennial kingdom is created, where Christ will reign on earth for 1,000 years. And you know, the way I understand this, this is kind of even a training period here too, because we have to go through 1,000 years before the New Jerusalem comes down. Revelations 5:10, there the saints are crying out, "You have made us a kingdom of priests, and we shall reign upon the earth. We shall reign with the Lord here." In Jerusalem, where Jesus Yeshua will sit on his throne. And then eventually, in 1 Corinthians 15:24, then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. And then in Ephesians 1:10, it also says that Christ is gathering all things in one. All of heaven, all of earth, everything in the entire universe will be gathered into one. And that's when we will see the New Jerusalem after the millennial reign come down out of heaven. Where is it coming down? It's coming down to earth. I believe right where Jerusalem is now. So when you pray for the peace of Jerusalem, you're praying for the Father's house to come here on earth. And I found a picture. I kind of like that picture. Leave that picture up, Terry, and I'll just read the scriptures. Revelations 21, John was shown. He said, "Come, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife." And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her light was like a most precious stone, like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. This is the restoration of all things. This is the restoration of the Garden of Eden on earth. We can't prove that the Garden of Eden was right where Jerusalem is, but I wouldn't be surprised if it was. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city has no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light, and the nations of those who are saved shall walk in the light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory and honor into it. And in the middle of the street, on either side of the river, is the tree of life. 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. I have a prophetic word. When I asked the Lord, "What do you want me to do?" I heard a scripture. This is for you. This is for our body and those listening on live stream. It was so sweet and so precious. Luke 12, 32. "Do not fear, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Jesus was speaking to the 12 disciples there, but he's speaking to this little flock now. The Father is. It's the Father's pleasure to give you the kingdom. So I'm going to end with the apple of his eye. We know. The apple of the eye is the opening, the gateway of the eye, the iris, and the pupil. I had the experience of being behind God the Father's eye and looking through it. I mean, he looked down, Jesus' eye too. He saw Abraham and that seed of faith that was planted in him. And then that seed goes to Isaac and then to Jacob and then to the 12 sons. He sees that seed passed on to King David, and then, of course, the manifestation of Jesus in the flesh on the earth, the seed himself. And then he goes through time, and as he's looking through the apple of his eyes, he sees you.
Yes.
You are
That's right.
Grafted in
Yeah.
to that natural tree. You are, as well as all the other believers, the apple of his eye.
Amen.
In this season of the feast, he is giving the threshing floor. Barley threshing floor is open. He's giving a fresh empowerment for anyone who wants to come and renounce the world or, you know, whatever. If you need healing or deliverance, I am an overcomer, and you will be too if you're not already, okay? I am in Israel. You are too.